Okay, in this video, we're going to cover 9.1, which is the linear and nonlinear systems of equations. So there's essentially three approaches, but in this section, I think they're going to concentrate on the graphical approach and the substitution approach. When we get to 9.2, we'll talk about those as well, but then we'll also talk about another method called the elimination or the addition method, okay? But for now, we're just working with these. So for the substitution method, it says, up to this point in the text, most problems have involved either a function of one variable or a single variable expression or a single equation in two variables, like y equals 5x minus 2, right? However, many problems in science, business, and engineering involve two or more equations in two or more variables. To solve such a problem, you need to find solutions of a system of equations. What that means is that your solution doesn't just satisfy one equation, it satisfies all the equations in the system, okay? Which is a lot harder to find, okay? So here's an example of a system of two equations in two variables. The variables are our unknowns, right? Those are our letters. So here's equation one, here's equation two, and together they create a system, okay? A solution of the system is an ordered pair, meaning a point, okay? It's a point that satisfies each or both equations in the system, okay? Finding the set of all solutions is called solving the system of equations. So for instance, the ordered pair 2, 1 is the solution of this system. To check this, you can substitute 2 for x and 1 for y in each equation. So if you took equation 1 and you plugged in 2 for x and 1 for y, you would get that it equals 5. If you look at equation 2 and you plug 2 for x and 1 for y, you would also get the value 4 in the equation. So it does check out for both equations. Now, you will study four ways to solve systems of equations. For the most part, it's really just one method that works for nonlinear linear, which is substitution. And then you have graphing, which could work for linear or nonlinear systems. And then you have this, I know what the fourth one is. And the fourth one is in chapter 10. So I told you about one method, which is substitution, one method that will eventually be the graphing method, one method in 9.2, which would be the elimination or addition method. And the fourth method is the one that we're gonna work on in chapter 10, and that's using matrices, okay? And actually with the matrices, there's three different ways you can use matrices. So really there's more than just four, but anyway, that's just a debate, mathematical debate. But let's concentrate on the substitution method, okay? So the steps for the substitution method are, you essentially grab one equation and just focus on one variable and try to get that variable by itself, okay? So it says solve one of the equations for one variable in terms of the other one, meaning you're gonna have to move the other letter to the other side and it's just gonna stick in there. It's gonna stay in there for a moment, okay? Then you're going to substitute the expression you found in step one into the other equation that you never messed with, okay? Once you have that, you're going to be able to solve that equation for that other variable, okay? Then when you solve for that other variable, you're going to back substitute what you had from step three into what you had for step one. And then that should help you figure out that first variable that you were trying to solve for, okay? Then the last thing, of course, you would always want to check your solution and make sure that it satisfies both of the equations. And the term back substitution implies that you work backwards, okay? So you put something in and then you got to eventually take it back out, okay? First, you solve for one of the variables and then you substitute that value back into one of the equations in the system to find the value of the other variable, okay? So here's an example. Here you have a system of two equations. This is equation one, this is equation two. And so then to do that, they went ahead and they took this top equation and they picked equation one and they said, I'm gonna get this guy by himself, okay? It doesn't matter what equation you use. There are four different ways to do this problem. I could pick the top equation and get him by himself. I could pick the top equation and get him by himself. I could pick the bottom equation and get y by itself. I could pick the bottom equation and get x by itself. So there's four different ways you could do it. You just pick and go, okay? So I'm just explaining to you what they did. There is no reason why they picked equation one and why they picked y, okay? I will tell you from my own personal experience, I would never solve for this guy just because anything that has a negative coefficient, I try to stay away from them if possible. If they all have negative coefficients, well, then I'm screwed. I'm going to have to do it with a negative, right? It's not a big deal, but I just personally try to avoid it if I can. So me personally, I would have never picked equation two and y to get by itself. I would have gotten x, this y, or this x by itself first. But I'm going to continue with what they chose. They chose to do solve for y in equation one. So to do that, you got to get y alone. So I would have to minus x on both sides. When you minus x on this side, it'll cancel, leaving you with just y. And if you minus x over here, you end up with the expression 4 minus x. Now remember, in step two, this will replace the y in the other equation. So I never touched equation two. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to write equation two, but then right here, instead of y, I'm going to put this whole expression in there instead of y, because y is equal to that, okay? So in the next line, notice that that's exactly what they did. They have x minus the y that you just saw equal to two. Then of course you do have to distribute your negative. So you end up with x minus four plus x. And it looks like here they added four to both sides. And they went ahead and did x plus x, which was 2x. And two plus four is six. Then you divide both sides by two and you get x by itself and six divided by two is three, okay? Then you take this answer and you go back to what you had for step one. This is the equation you had for step one when you got y by itself. So now you're just gonna plug that three in for x. So this x becomes this three. And four minus three is just one. So you get y equal to one. So then your solution is a point, okay? And that is the x value comma the y value you just found. Okay. And then to check it, we plug it in equation one. So we plug three for x, one for y, and it does come out to be four. If we do it into equation two, we have three for x, one for y, and that does equal two. And so then the point three comma one is the solution to the system. Now for nonlinear systems, you can do substitution. Okay. And with non-linear, so I know nobody likes to graph, okay? That's just true, okay? I've never met somebody that was like super excited to graph anything. So, especially by hand when you don't have a graphing calculator, right? So typically our favorite method is never going to be to graph everything because it requires a lot of detail and a lot of work to graph something, okay? And if your solutions happen to be something weird like the square root of five or, you know, a decimal 0.78, are you really gonna be able to determine that by looking at your paper? No, right? So the graphing method is usually not used with nonlinear systems. It could be used, but it's typically not going to be in favor because it only works if your answers are whole numbers, right? If the components in your point are both whole numbers. Because then I can tell, you know, it lands on right on the corner of a little box and I know what the solution is. But not all the solutions are going to be whole numbers. They could be fractions. They could be decimals. They could be radicals that don't simplify. So I typically don't do nonlinear systems using the graphing method only. I might verify something in a graph, but I will never use that as a way to solve. Okay. So we're going to do it using the method of substitution. Okay. So let's see a system that is nonlinear. So as soon as you have this x squared in there, this is nonlinear. See, without it, those are both linear, powers of 1 on all the x's and all the y's. But since this one has a power of 2, it's no longer linear, okay? But I can still take one equation and solve for one of the variables. Now, they chose to take equation 2 and solve for y. There is a reason why they did it this time, okay? One, there's 2 x's here, and it's going to be pretty difficult to solve for just 1 x, okay? So you don't ever want to take this one as the one you start with. You want to take the simpler equation and go with that one, okay? So there is a reason why they started with equation 2, and that's because this equation is more simple than the other one, okay? Then personally, me, I would have got x by itself versus getting y by itself. But in order to get x by itself, at some point, I'm going to have to divide everybody by 2. And when I do that, it's going to create fractions. So they might have been trying to avoid fractions there, okay? Doesn't mean you can't do it with fractions. It's just a preference, okay? So to avoid having fractions, they chose to get the y by itself. Now, they just write the answer there, but I'm going to explain where it came from. So if I'm trying to get y by itself, I'm going to minus 2x on both sides. And if I minus 2x on both sides, I'm going to end up with negative y equal to negative 2x minus 1. I still need to get y completely by itself, so I'm going to divide by negative 1. And then I would get positive y, a negative would give me positive 2x, and a negative would give me positive 1. And so that's where this came from, okay? Now, what do? If we know that y is equivalent to this expression, then when we go back and look at equation 1, we can write that expression instead of this y value, okay? So notice that you have the 3x squared plus 4x minus, and then always in parentheses when you plug something in, goes that expression 2x plus 1. Every time you plug in something into a function, you should always use parentheses, okay? You can decide later if you need them, but at first have them, okay? So then I notice that I have a negative, so that negative does need to get distributive, which means that my next line would be 3x squared plus 4x minus 2x minus 1 equal to 7. And then if I combine my like terms, I have 3x squared, these two guys together make positive 2x minus 1 equal to 7. It is a quadratic, and the square is over here, so I would want to get everybody over. And so then I end up with down here, 3x squared plus 2x, and these two guys together make negative 8. And of course, now this is gone, so I have 0 on this side. Now you can factor it. It seems like it's factorable because they did it, right? But if you cannot factor, you can do the quadratic formula to get the same two answers, okay? So I've always mentioned that, right? If you are great at factoring, it does save time. But if you're not great at factoring, you can always solve a quadratic by using the quadratic formula. So either way, you should still end up with these two solutions, 4/3 and negative 2. And then you have to back sub. So you have 2 x values, which means each x value should have a corresponding y value. How am I going to figure out what that is? You're going to plug it back into the expression that you found for part 1. So over here, you're going to end up getting 8 over 3 plus 1, which is 11 over 3. And over here, you're going to get negative 4 plus 1, which means you get negative 3. So for the x value 4/3, the y value you found was 11 over 3. And for x equal to negative 2, the y value you found was negative 3. So you have 2 points that are solutions, okay? So essentially what that means is that their graphs will cross twice, okay? And those are the 2 points where they will, the 2 graphs will touch. And then here it's just actually, that's the wrong page. Just checking your solutions. You should always check your solutions, but in this case, I'm not going to check them. I'm just going to assume that we did everything correct, okay? So in example 3, the system of equations in 2 unknowns can have exactly 1 solution or more than 1 solution, and it could even have no solution. It is totally possible to have no solution, okay? By using a graphical method, you can gain insight about the number of solutions and like the locations or close locations of those solutions. The solutions of the system correspond to the points of intersection. So if you draw both of those equations, you were to draw their graphs, wherever they touch or intersect, that's a solution to the system. So here's some graphical approach information. So here's an example of two equations, right? So here's my two equations. And if I were to graph one equation and graph the other equation, where they cross is their solution. So this happens to be the solution of this system. Same thing in this one, you have a squared function and then you have a line, right? And this one happens to have two points of intersection, right? And so 2, 1 and 0, negative 1 is a solution. This is very similar to the situation we just worked with, okay? Now here's another system where you have a line and they've graphed that line and you have this parabola and they've graphed this parabola. But with this going downward and downward forever and these going off to the left and downward and up to the right forever, they're never going to intersect ever. And so in this case, you have no intersection points, which means here you have one solution, here you have multiple solutions, and here you have no solution. Now, we do have systems of nonlinear, right? So you could have some logarithms and some exponentials in there. We shouldn't be afraid of those anymore because we had a whole chapter talking about them, right? So even if they throw one in there, it's not that big of a deal. So if you were to graph this equation, you would get the ln of x curve. And then if you were to graph this, this is the same as y equals negative x plus 1, which is this curve here, right? You have a negative 1 slope and a y-intercept of 1, x-intercept of 1. And it just so happens that they both intersect at this point 1, 0. And so 1, 0 is a solution. Now, if you check your answer into both of those equations, you can. So if 1, 0, remember this is x and this is y. So this would become 0 and this would become 1. And we already know in the calculator ln of 1 is 0. Here, if we plug in 1 for x and 0 for y, 1 plus 0 is 1. So it checks out into both. Now, example 3 shows the benefit of a graphical approach to solving systems of equations in two variables, notice by trying only the substitution method in example 3. You would obtain this equation, x plus ln of x equal to 1. It would be difficult to solve this equation for x using standard algebraic techniques. Like if that x were not there, I could solve it. Or if this were not there, I could solve it. It would be already solved. But to put them two together, you can't because this is inside an argument. You can't even factor out an X or nothing. None of the techniques that we know, which is factoring, solving quadratic formula, one-to-one properties, or what is the other one? Anyway, but none of the algebraic techniques that we know so far will enable us to be able to solve that. So that's why systems, solving it by substitution can come in handy a lot. And if substitution does not come in handy, actually this is one that's showing you that if you did substitution, you wouldn't be able to do it, okay? So you would have to be able to look at the graph and at least kind of hopefully see where the answer is, okay? Now for applications, we do use systems of equations, whether they be linear or nonlinear, when referring to basic business models. These are not like the complicated ones that people are actually using. It's pretty basic, okay? So it says the total cost C of producing X units of a product typically has two components, the initial cost and the cost per unit. When enough units have been sold so that the total revenue R equals the total cost, revenue is the amount of money you made from selling, okay? The sales are said to have reached the break-even point, okay? So when your revenue equals your cost, you have just broken even. Anything else extra revenue above that, then you're starting to get into the profit phases of your business, right? It says you will find that break-even point corresponds to the point of intersection of the cost and the cost revenue curves. Doesn't mean we have to draw them all the time, but it's just letting you know. Okay. So it says a shoe company invests $300,000 in equipment to produce a new line of athletic footwear. Each pair of shoes costs $5 to produce and is sold for $60. How many pairs of shoes must be sold before the business breaks even? So remember, their initial cost was this $300,000 that they had to do to create the equipment, okay? So that's going to be your initial cost. And we know that the items, how much they cost to create is going to be $5 per the number of items. Now, I don't know the number of items. It's asking me to find how many, okay? How many pairs of shoes need to be sold? But I know that the cost is going to be $5 times each shoe, pair of shoe that's sold or created, plus $300,000. This is the cost function. Now, for the revenue function, that's the amount of money that you make. So it's going to be the price that you're selling them for times however many you sell them. Now, I don't know how many I'm selling just yet. I want to know how many I would have to sell to break even, okay? So we don't know this number yet, which is why they keep using the variable X. But your revenue would come from that $60 price per pair of shoes. So the break even point is when R equals C, okay? So in a sense, I don't ever do it like this, but they're just saying that it is like that, okay? But what I usually do is if you have R equal to 60x and you have C equal to 5x plus 300,000, and you're telling me that R equals C, well, guess what? That means that this expression equals that expression, right? That 60x equals 5x plus this big number, okay? And then I could solve that number, right? I could just subtract 5x on both sides, and I'd get that 55x equals this 300,000. Then I could divide by 55 and get that x equals 5.5. You can't sell half a shoe, so you would definitely have to sell 5.455 pairs. Okay, because you're talking about shoes here. Now I want to see what they did. So let's see what they did. So they did end up saying the R equal to the cost, right? And then they subtracted the 5x over and they divided and they rounded up. Okay. So then the company has to sell 5,455 pairs just to break even because they made that big, large investment, okay? Now, another way to view the solution in example four is to consider the profit function. Now, profit is when you take the amount of money you made and you subtract the cost and you have something more than, it's not negative, which means you're in the negative, and it's not zero, okay? It's an actual profit. Okay. But when the profit is zero, well, guess what? When the profit is zero, don't you have this equation? And if I add C to both sides, I get that C equals R. That's the same thing as saying R equals C. Okay. So you are essentially finding the break-even point if you set the profit equal to zero. Because you're not going to have any profit. You're not going to owe anything. You're not going to make anything. You just broke even. Okay. So let's go ahead and go to these practice problems. So for number one, it says solve the system by method of substitution. So I'm going to take one equation and get one letter by itself. It doesn't matter. So I'm going to grab this top equation and I'm going to go ahead, since y does not have a number in front and it's positive, I'm going to get this guy by himself, okay? Which means I need a minus 3x over. So I get y equal to 12 minus 3x. And then remember that gets substituted into the other one. So instead of this, this is gonna go in there. So I'm gonna have negative x plus 12 minus 3x. Now if I distribute a positive 1, nothing's going to change. This is still going to be a positive 12, and that's still going to be a negative 3x. I can combine my like terms. I can move over the 12. And I can divide by negative 4. So I get x equals to positive 3. Then I can plug that back into what I had from step 1 and say y equals 12 minus 3 times 3. So y equals 12 times 9, or y equals 3, which means my answer is 3 for x, and it just so happens the same 3 for y. But this is my solution. Okay, now here's practice number 2. It's another problem. Now notice that all the guys without a power all have negatives. So I really don't have a choice, which, whether x or y, okay? But I'm definitely not gonna take the top equation because it has an exponent on it. So I'm gonna take the bottom equation and I'm gonna try to get one of these letters by itself. Both of them have a negative. So one is not more preferable than the other. It really doesn't matter. And since they've been solving for y all the time, I just want to solve for x to show you it doesn't matter. Okay, you could still get your solution. So I'm actually going to get this guy by himself, which means I need to add the y over. So I have negative x equals, and it's positive y, so I'm going to write y minus 5. And then to get x all alone, I have to divide every single term by negative 1. So this becomes positive, this becomes negative, and this becomes positive. Okay, then what happens? In the top equation, x squared minus y equal to negative 3, this is going to replace the x right there. Okay, so it's going to become negative y plus 5 squared minus y equals to negative 3. Well, that means negative y plus 5 times negative y plus 5. So y, negative and negative, would be positive y squared. That would be minus 5y, minus 5y, and plus 25, minus y, equal negative 3. If I combine all my like terms, I have negative 11y plus 25 equal to negative 3. And if I add 3 on both sides, because I do have a quadratic, you want everything on one side, I end up with this. And that might be factorable. 4 and 7 do make 11. So y minus 7 and y minus 4. Again, if you cannot factor, then do the quadratic formula. You should still end up with the same solutions, positive 7 and positive 4. Okay. Now there's two different y's. So you are going to go back to this expression, but you're going to have two solutions. So you're going to have x equals negative 7 plus 5, and then you're going to have x equals negative 4 plus 5. So this means negative 7 plus 5, which is negative 2, and this is negative 4 plus 5, which is 1. So for the x value, negative 2, the y value was 7, and then for the x value of 1, the y value was 4. And so both of these are your solution points. So you had two solutions with this one. Now, number 3 says, use a system of equations to find the dimensions of a rectangle meeting the specified conditions. So you've got a rectangle here. This is the length, this is the width. It's saying that the perimeter is 84 inches. So this sentence right there, perimeter means to add up all the sides. So you're gonna add up 2 lengths plus 2 W's, and that should be 84 inches, okay? It also tells you that the width is 3/4 of the length, okay? And so this is your system of equations. You've got two equations with two unknowns, length and width, okay? Now notice that over here, you already have one of the letters all by itself. So you could just jump straight into your substitution. So instead of W over here, you're going to use the expression of what W is equivalent to. So this will become 2L plus 2 times 3/4 L equal to 84. Now, I'm going to multiply that first before I get rid of the, because this is like over 1. So it's actually 6 over 4L equal to 84. It could reduce to 3/2. So I'm going to actually reduce it to 3/2. Okay. And then you do have a denominator still of 2. So I'm going to multiply every single term times 2. And that will cancel the 2 down there. But 2 times 2L is 4L. These 2s are gone, so I just have 3L. And then 2 times 84 is 168, I believe. Yep, 168. But these can be combined to make 7L. And if I divide both sides by 7, I get that L equals 24. And then you already have a formula for the width. So the width is gonna be 3/4 times 24, which is 18, right? So let's see, 3/4 times 24. Yeah, it does come out to 18. So then now we know. And in the computer, pay attention because I don't know which box is gonna be where. But make sure that you put the 18 in the box for width and then put 24 in the box for length. When you're doing the WebAssign. Okay, so another problem here says the given amount of annual interest is earned from a total of $12,000 invested in two funds paying simple interest. Simple interest is a different formula than the PERT formula or the big one. Simple interest is just interest equals principal times rate times time, okay? Things in the real world do not function on simple interest, but if you were to get a loan from your uncle or something or your grandma, whoever, they're the ones that will probably, if they're gonna charge you interest, they'd be using simple interest just because it's really easy to compute. And the values that you get are not very far off than if you were to use one of those more complicated formulas. So it says, write and solve a system of equations to find the amount invested at each rate. So here's the annual interest, okay? Now we do know that we're putting it in two different accounts. So we know that the annual interest is gonna be the interest from one account plus the interest from another account, okay? So if I want to talk about the interest from the first account, I also know that $12,000 is the total amount invested. So total invested is going to be that $12,000. And I also know that that's going to be the principal for one account plus the principal for the other account. Both of the principals or both of the investments total this $12,000, okay? And I know that I1 is going to be P1 times R1 times T. And I know that I2 is gonna be P2 times R2 times T. And it doesn't tell me how long to leave it in there. It doesn't say how long. It says two funds. It just, oh, it says annual. So that means, that also means that your T is equal to 1, okay? So when I find I1, I'm gonna get P1 times rate 1, which is 0.04, times the time, which is 1 for annual. I know I2 is gonna be P2, whatever that is, times this rate, and then times time, which is 1 year, okay? Problem is you still have two variables and two equations. However, you have this extra third equation that gives you some insight on what to do over here, okay? So what you wanna do is you wanna solve for one of these variables, okay? You actually have four equations. You have, it's like this. This is equation 1, this is equation 2, This is equation 3, and this is equation 4. And so we've got to put all of it together. It's really complicated, okay? So now that I have these equations and all the information I could possibly have, I do want to make them both have the same variable, okay? Because if this one and this one have the same variable, then I can put that in here and there'll only be one variable, okay? And if there's only one variable, then I can solve for that one variable. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna pick a letter to solve for. I'm just gonna get P1 by itself. So I'm gonna minus P2 on both sides. So what I get is that P1 is gonna be the 12,000 minus P2, okay? Right, isn't that what we get from over here? We get 12,000 minus P2 equals P1, okay? So now if I'm gonna leave it alone like that, but now I have an expression. So if I put all of this stuff together, I'm gonna get 630 equals to I1. So instead of I1, I'm gonna put what it's equivalent to. Plus I2, so I'm gonna put what I2 is equal to. And then I'm gonna solve this equation because there's only one variable in that whole equation. So before I do that, I do need to clean it up. 1 times this is still 0.04. And 1 times 0.06 is 0.06. And then here I do have to distribute. So let me see. 0.04 times 12,000. I get 480 minus 0.04 P2 plus 0.06 P2. If I minus 480 on both sides, 630 minus 480, there, 640 minus 480, I get 160 equals, and if I combine those, I get 0.02 P2. If I divide both sides by 0.02, I will get P2 by itself. And 160 divided by 0.02 happens to be 8,000. And so it says, find the amount invested at each given rate. So what do they want to know? They want to know P1 and P2. And I have already found P2, right? So I know how much they're going to invest at 6%. It's going to be $8,000 at this rate, okay? But if I want to find the other one, well, look, I have an equation on how to find P1. So I'm going to plug that back into there. So it's 12,000 minus 8,000 equals P1. So 4,000 equals P1. And so then that means I would be depositing or investing 4,000 at the other rate, the first rate, okay? And so now I do have both of those answers, but that one was quite crazy because it had 4 different equations and we had to compile them all together to hopefully try to get one equation with just one variable. Okay, now last, example in this section says, what are the dimensions of a rectangular tract of land when its perimeter is 70 kilometers? So let's say length, width. So 2 of the length sides plus 2 of the width sides should equal 70 kilometers. The area is that. So length times width should equal 304 square kilometers. Enter the lengths of the sides as a comma separated list, okay? So they don't wanna know the length is this, the width is that, just put them both with a comma in between. So remember, you have to pick one and solve for one of the variables, okay? However you wanna do that is up to you. To me, this seems like a little bit easier to solve for a variable, but sometimes people don't want fractions. And so they might, you're still gonna end up with fractions, but whatever, they might choose this one. If you choose that one, you'd have to pick a letter. I'll just choose L. No reason. I just chose it. Okay. So I'm going to minus 2W on both sides. And I get 2L alone, 70 minus 2W. And then I have to divide everybody by 2. And because 70 was an even number, we got lucky and that we didn't end up with any fractions. Okay. So when I come over to here, remember, this is going to replace the L. So it becomes 35 minus W times W equal to 304. Anytime you have one factor times a binomial, you have to distribute. So this will become 35W minus W squared equal to 304. Now, normally, wherever the W squared is, I would move this over, but it's a negative W squared, and I don't like that. So I'm actually going to move both of these terms the other way, so that then I could have a positive W squared. So these will both be gone, giving me zero, and those I'm going to put in order. So positive W squared minus 35W, and then a positive 304. And again, if you can factor it, you would factor it. But if you cannot factor it, it actually can be factored, but if not, you can always use the quadratic formula. But it's actually W minus 16 and W minus 19. And so then you would get W equal to 16 or 19. Now, if W equals 16, then the length would equal 35 minus 16, which is 19. And if W equals 19, then the length would be 35 minus 19, which is 16. This one doesn't make any sense because your length is always supposed to be longer than your width. So that one just doesn't make any sense. But if you notice, you got the same dimensions for both of them, right? They're 16 by 19 kilometers, okay? So what are the dimensions? It's gonna be 16 kilometers and then 19 kilometers. They may not want you to put the units in there, but that's the dimensions. Okay. And again, you could have also gotten the same two answers using the quadratic formula. Okay. I just did it factoring because it was factorable. Okay, that is the end of this section. So hopefully you can get started with your WebAssign. And always, 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 if you're getting stuck on stuff in WebAssign, just text me a photo of the problem, a photo of what you're trying to do, and I can help you figure it out. But other than that, you guys have a great day.